So the question reads that these increasing demands could alter the saline content, which would rob the oysters of their flavor. And the question itself has an immediate red flag in the pronoun which. Now, why is this a red flag? Now, keep in mind to look out for the which trap. Now, this does not only apply to the pronoun which, but also other ones like it, this, that, etc. So let me give you an example here. He won the first prize, which made his family happy. Now, when you read this, this might seem just fine. The sentence might sound fine, but let's take a closer look. You see, we're using a pronoun which. And if which is a pronoun, what is a pronoun supposed to refer to? It can only refer to a noun. So, the pronoun is actually referring to the first prize. That's the noun right in front of it. But is that what the sentence intends? Are we trying to say that the first prize made his family happy, or his winning the first prize made his family happy? I think you'll all agree that the latter is the case, that the winning the first prize is what made his family happy. So this is GMAT's way of trying to trap you into thinking that the which could refer to the action, because in speech or in other forms of writing, it's totally fine to use the which this way. But on the GMAT, this is a certain red flag. So every time you see a which and any of these pronouns, make sure you understand whether GMAT is trying to trap you with the which trap. Whether the which is actually referring back to the noun, or is it trying to modify an action. So this should not work. And that's the exact reason why A would not work. Because in the original sentence, the which would refer back to the bay. But what is actually robbing the oysters of the flavor? The alteration of the saline content. So the which cannot be referring to this particular action. So A is out. Now B has the pronoun it. So instead of the which, it's now an it, and it would rob. So what would rob the flavor? It's the alteration of the saline content, correct? So once again, we have the pronoun it referring back to an action, and that doesn't work. Now, even if you argue that, well, it could be the increasing demands, first of all, it's a clear mismatch in number, because increasing demands is plural and it is singular. And secondly, it wouldn't make logical sense to say that the increasing demands would rob the oysters of the flavor. B goes off. Now, when you vertically scan C, D, and E, the split that is obvious is and rob and robbing. So how can we work with these differences? Well, let me modify this example a bit. Let's say he won the first prize and made his family happy. Or he won the first prize, comma, making his family happy. So generally, when we read these two, people would be inclined to go for the first one, because that's what sounds fine, correct? But we should keep in mind what exactly this and conjunction is doing here. See, the conjunction and is definitely connecting these two verbs, these two clauses, he won and made. But it also makes these two independent actions. That means it would indicate that he won the first prize separately and he made his family happy separately. But is that what the sentence's intended meaning should be? So here, when you say comma making, what would this become? This is a present participle modifier. And how does a present participle work? Well, it modifies the entire clause in front of it and applies to the subject. So this can modify the meaning properly. But how does it impact the meaning? There are two meanings that can be conveyed by the present participle modifier at the end of the clause. It can either be a case of simultaneous actions or cause and effect. So what exactly are we trying to do here? He won the first prize, comma, making his family happy would indicate a clear case of cause and effect, that his winning the first prize is the reason why his family is happy. So in the same way, we know that Robbing and making them smaller is a direct effect of the increasing demands altering the saline content. So C cannot work because the AND would separate them as two different actions. So both D and E can work in that way that we have an ing modifier which is modifying the clause in front of it. So let's look for another difference here. And one obvious thing that will strike is smaller and decrease in size. And we can argue that smaller is a much more straightforward way of saying decrease in size. But again, let's not take a leap of faith in this manner. We can see that there is a comma which is preceding the AND in E, but there's no comma in D. What does this mean? Well, generally we know that AND is a trigger for the concept of parallelism, correct? So if I have an AND here, we see that it's connecting these two actions, robbing and making. But this AND is definitely not connecting these two actions, robbing and making, and that's because of this comma. See, when you write a list and that list comprises of only two items like bread and butter, eggs and bacon, you don't need to put a comma before the AND. But if a list is made up of anything more than two items, we can put a comma before the AND for the last item. But here we can see that there are only two things here, robbing and making. So in that sense, we should not put a comma in front of the AND. And if I introduce a comma, what happens is now this AND becomes a conjunction that stops the clause here and introduces a new clause here. So if it's introducing a new clause here, this making them decrease in size becomes a new present participle modifier, which is supposed to modify something. But we can see that after this modifier, there is no clause construction at all, which means this is a dangling modifier, not modifying anything for that matter. So this is an incomplete construction, and that is why E goes off. This leaves us with the right answer choice, D for delta.